بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى أهله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, today inshallah we move on to hadith number 16. Now, if y'all recall correctly, we started the hadith that we're on right now featuring a new companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Al-Mughirah ibn Shu'bah. Let's now begin with the hadith. Let's see what Mughirah hath to say. Mughirah radiallahu an, he says that Muawiyah radiallahu an wrote to him a letter. Now, if y'all recall correctly, we said Mughirah radiallahu an politically sided with Muawiyah radiallahu an, and we discussed that controversy briefly last time. So he writes him a letter, Muawiyah, who's the Amir at that time, and he says, I want you to write me back with something that you heard directly from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Not hearsay, not what he said or she said. I want to know what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam directly said. And whatever that is, write it down and mail me. So, when Mughirah radiallahu anhu finally gets the letter, he has one of his typists, if you will, write down the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And now here's a hadith. Mughirah ibn Shu'bah says, I heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prohibiting three things. And subhanAllah, this hadith is so nice. Easy to memorize, it actually rhymes, and you can easily commit it to memory. I'll share with you the Arabic first to show you how cool it sounds, and then I'll translate it for you. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, yanha an kathrati su'al wa an ida'ati al-mal wa an qila wa qal. That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prohibited, forbade the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam what? Excessive questioning, pointless questioning. That's the first thing on the list. Second thing on the list, ida'atil mal, financial waste, just blowing your money left and right without, you know, care or concern. And then the third thing that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam forbade was useless conversations and back and forth and debates. So once again, three things. First on the list was, if you all recall correctly, kathratis su'al, excessive pointless questioning that has no benefit. Number two, financial waste. Number three, useless conversations and arguments. What I'm going to do, inshallah, we're going to discuss the first part of the hadith today, and we're going to combine first and the third together, which is excessive questioning and useless talking. The first and the last on the list. Once again, pointless questioning and completely futile back and forth. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, let's begin. Our deen, when you study it, you realize something very important, and that is that Islam places a premium on action and not so much on discussion. Like our deen, over and over again, there's one emphasis, that is less discussion, more action. Less talking, more doing. And you see this theme come up over and over again. In Urdu, there's a really nice saying. They say, garaj, jo garajte hain, wo baraste nahin. I don't know if you guys ever heard of it. I'll translate it for you. Cloud that thunders the loudest, rains the least. So you don't want to be one of those people who just are all talk, long meetings, no follow through. Long discussion, but no action. Long questionnaires, but very little that comes out of it. We don't want to be those types of individuals who confuse activity for success. You know how many times this happens when a person, they know they're lazy. They know they're not very productive. So they psychologically cope with that by asking a lot of questions. Always just nitty gritty into things, just pointlessly, without much benefit. A lot of time goes into just useless investigation and no action kind of comes out of it. Our deen discourages that. That you want to be a person of action, person of activism, not just constantly interrogating things. A man came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this regard, and he says, Ya Rasulullah, mata sa'atu qa'ima? Look at the question he asks. He's like, Ya Rasulullah, when is the day of judgment? Now this right here is what you can call a useless question. Why? Because no one knows. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has already clarified in a hadith of Jibreel that comes in Muslim and Bukhari, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Mal mas'ulu anha bi a'lama min as-sa'il." Neither the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam knows, neither Jibreel knows, Neither the greatest of man, nor the greatest of angel. Nobody knows, yet this man still comes and says, yo, when's the day of judgment? I want to know. The Prophet ﷺ, to do a paradigm shift, so we can start moving away from philosophical mumbo-jumbo about when is the day of judgment, the Illuminatis and the Dajjal, and you know how young people are into this stuff, the conspiracy theories. Stop focusing on that. What's a better question? He counters with another question, and he says, وَمَا أَعْدَدْتَ لَهَا. Instead of asking when is the day of judgment, what you should be asking is, what have you prepared for it? Because that demands action. And that's inconvenient for the nafs. But what's more convenient for the nafs is to be an armchair critic. You just talk all day, just comment all day. You got nothing to show for yourself. That's the kind of thing that our religion discourages. Let me give you another example of a question the Prophet ﷺ was upset about. He was really not happy about this question. Hadith comes in Tirmidhi from Ali radiallahu anhu that the Prophet ﷺ, when the ayah came down, وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حِجُّ الْبَيْتِ مَنِ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا. Ayah came down that Hajj is now an obligation upon humanity to their Creator. They owe it to their Creator to do Hajj. The ayah came down. Very strong obligation. A man asks the Prophet ﷺ when he heard this ayah, he's like, Ya Rasulullah, afi kulli aam? Is it every year? Just appreciate the question here. He hears that Hajj is an obligation and he's like, yeah, so is it every year now? This overachiever right here. So the Prophet ﷺ, when he heard this question, he remained silent. Very wisely. Why? Because one of the possible answers is yes. And were the Prophet ﷺ to say yes, it would become an obligation and we couldn't do it. Imagine what would happen to the Muslim countries and their economies if all Muslims left for Hajj every year. It would bankrupt. So he's like, Ya Rasulullah, is it every year? Prophet ﷺ is silent. So he repeats the question. Is it every year? The Prophet ﷺ is still silent. Third time the man asks the question and now the Prophet ﷺ is upset. And the Prophet ﷺ says, it's not an obligation every year, but had I said yes, it would become an obligation and you couldn't bear it. Then why would you ask questions, the response of which is impossible for you? There's no manfa'a in this, no jadwa in this. Why are you engaging in hypotheticals and questions that you would be upset by the answer yourself? So this was one question the Prophet ﷺ kind of taught the companions, like, where do you draw the line between beneficial questions and just speculations? And I tell you folks something, companions of the Prophet ﷺ had to be extra cautious. Why? Because they lived at a time where the doors of revelation are open. If they ask too many questions, what could happen? Revelation could come down with more rulings that weren't there previously. Well, like, let me give you a really good example of this. We know in our deen, when there's no water available, what do you do to pray? What do you do to get ready for prayer? If you don't have water, what do? Tayammum. Where Allah says in the Quran, فَتَيَمَّمُوا صَعِيدًا طَيِّبًا. That when you're looking to make tayammum, use any earthly material that's on the surface of the earth that's clean. Look at the flexible, open language. Anything that is earthly in nature and pure, do tayammum with this. Hanafi school of thought says, Allah left it open-ended. He said, anything on the surface of the earth that is earthly and pure, legitimate to make tayammum out of it. So, according to the Hanafi school of thought, you can make tayammum from soil, sand, limestone, rocks. All is fair game. Why? They say because Allah left it open-ended. He left it flexible, so we're going to enjoy the flexibility. Imagine if the Sahaba were being overachievers and fiqh warriors, and they're like, Messenger of God, like, what kind of earthly material? And they kept asking that. More revelation would come down and restrict the flexibility that was there. The Sahaba had to be careful. Anas radiallahu anhu would say, sometimes I would have a question in my mind for a year and I wouldn't ask for the fear that my excessive questioning would trigger additional rulings that future generations of the Muslims would have to worry about because I was being, you know, the curious George. Sahaba were extra cautious. Bottom line, my dear brothers and sisters, what's being discouraged here is that Our Prophet ﷺ is trying to cure the attitude where people dodge responsibility by asking questions. It happens all the time. It's like, to give you an example, in our own households, the wife, out of the blue, once in a blue moon, will ask the husband to cook for a change. And now the husband obviously doesn't want to do it. So what is he going to do? He's going to ask the most ridiculous questions possible. Honey, how much salt should I put? How much pepper? How intense the stove should be? How much should I stare? Clockwise, counterclockwise? And the wife is sitting there and her blood is boiling now more than the stew itself that's supposed to be cooking. And after a while, she's like, you know what? It would pain me less to cook than to answer your moronic questions. And she ends up doing the cooking. You're like, that's dodging responsibility. One of our great imams, Al-Amash, he had a son who was very absent-minded. And he had this habit of asking dumb questions that after a while, like, would just set you off, right? So Imam Al-Amash, he's a great scholar of hadith, but he had a very eccentric personality. So once he asked his son, he's like, yo, go to the market and fetch me a rope. You know, a simple rope. Back in the day, it's not like there's so much variety. There's a simple forward rope, just go get it. This absent-minded son, he always zoned out, never paid attention. He's like, Dad, what did you say? He's like, go get me a rope. He's like, where? The market. It's not that hard. He's like, how long should the rope be? 10 feet. And then he's like, how wide should it be? And now Armash lost it. He's like, what did you ask? He's like, how wide should it be? Imam Armash is like, as wide as my misfortune in having you. Just roasted him on the spot because of excessive questioning that got out of hand. So we're just trying to make sure that we don't end up cultivating a habit of asking these types of questions. I leave you with this. What are some questions that are discouraged? First on the list, scholars, they say when the Prophet ﷺ forbade against excessive questioning, first on the list is excessively asking people for money. Always asking people, hey, yo, can I borrow $200? Hey, can I borrow your car? Can I borrow your bike? And then you don't even return stuff. That's another problem on top. Always just casually, carelessly, just always using people as your crutch, that is something that is discouraged. Number two that is discouraged in our deen is asking questions that are pointless, that have no benefit in it. What does that mean? For example, Imam Sharbi was once asked by somebody, I mean, look at the uselessness and just pointlessness of this question. He's like, what is the name of Shaitan's wife? What is the name of Shaitan's wife? Imam Sharbi says, that's a wedding I didn't attend. Straight up. Just to kind of put this person in his place, like, even if you knew the name, how would that benefit you in your religiosity? So questions that have no benefit. People will ask questions like when they hear the story of Yusuf alayhi salam and how the shirt was like taken by the brothers. What was the color of the shirt? What was the name of the lady who seduced him? People get into side details and get distracted from the main point. And the final thing on the list is scholars, they discourage too many hypotheticals. Where people are always asking these outrageous hypotheticals that are probably, or there's a very little chance of them occurring. So for example, someone will come to the sheikh and he's like, hey sheikh, if I was on the moon, which direction would the qibla be? Well, unless you're an astronaut, like, okay, fine, if you're training somebody's mental capacities, that's a good question to ask. But indulging in useless questions that, again, are very rarely or unlikely to occur is also something that is discouraged. And finally, poking into people's privacy and their private details of their lives, that is something that is also discouraged. I promise I end with this. One of our great scholars, Junaid, it's such a beautiful story, I have to squeeze it in. One of the great scholars of Islam, Junaid, when he passed away, he was seen in a dream. So his student, Ja'far, he asked him, how did Allah deal with you now that you have left this world? Junaid was a great scholar, wrote books, gave khutbas, got into debates. So now they're asking him, how did Allah deal with you when you left this world? Junaid says, all my fancy talks and all my fancy writings and all my colorful debates were of no use to me. About the only thing that benefited me were two ruqayat in the middle of the night that I used to pray. Ruqayat, two short rak'ahs that I would manage to squeeze in the middle of all this debating and talking. Wallahi, that's the only thing that benefited me. Not all that questioning and useless talking, but actually the action. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those who are people of action. Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun. Wa salamun ala al-mursaleen. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.